So the next room that I'm going to make a start on is this small office room or study room, whatever you want to call it, which is at the front of the house here. Now this doesn't look like a bad sized room, but in terms of fitting a desk and things in, obviously once you start to get a chair and a desk and you know, furniture in there, it is going to fill up the room quite quickly. And this had previously been used as a playroom for the little girl who lived with the family here. So my plan in this room is to actually try and build a desk into the window. If you look at the kind of architect's drawing of the house, there's some sort of strange shaped desk against the wall there, which looks like it doesn't quite fit. I'm not quite sure how they've gone about drawing that. But my plan here, in order to maximise the usage of the room, is in this bay window here. The windowsill there is high enough up that a desk working height would be below where the windowsill is there. So what I would like to do is basically, once I get the room ready, put battening around the wall here, right the way across the window and down to the other side, get a big piece of wood to then go across all that battening, potentially support it a little way in if it needs it. I'll have to think about that, and then give it a nice hardwood top of some description. And what that will do is give obviously kind of shallow bits at the sides to the desk, but then in the center section there where the bay goes in, obviously it'll give a decent working area. And that means then when there's a chair and things in the room, it's going to be kind of, you know, here somewhere, and the room doesn't actually feel too cramped. If you were to put a desk against the wall, by the time you get the desk out and the chair out, you can always feel like you sat very close to the other wall, and I think that would be more awkward. That also means that I'm not getting direct sunlight on the computer screen, so I think that's the best way to do it. And I can also see, obviously, out of the window if needs be. So in terms of the actual work to do in here, I've got some preparation to do. There's been various things mounted on the walls. So there's lots of plugs and holes and things in the walls. There's a little bit of cracking and stuff around the windows. The skirting board here, because it's quite a new house, in most of the rooms the skirting boards have separated a little bit on the corner where there's been a little bit of movement in the house. That all needs filling round. Everything needs painting. It needs a new light. There's nothing up in here at the moment other than just a standard light drop. So it'll get a nice light and everything else. So I'll make a start on the preparation, and then you can watch the room go together. In terms of the painting in here, there's going to be a relatively dark colour scheme in here. This is a north facing room, but I think it'll look quite classy with it being an office room if I paint it a relatively dark colour. And then to finish off, there'll be some nice pictures on the walls, just to actually break up the walls as well there. One thing which would have been nice to do in here is to get some plugs over under where the desk is going to be. The closest plug socket is on the wall there, so it's not miles away. I really don't want to actually start hacking away at the walls to get cable fed, just because I've got so much work to do. Obviously, every time you make big holes, you've then got to, you know, stick something to the back and fill it and sand it and everything. I really, you know, it's too much just to add in that amount of work. So I will have to kind of neatly run some cable over to the desk somehow. When the desk is in, I will plan to mount the majority of the cabling up to the underside of the desk, so you won't see it all on the floor. But I might have to get a power cable over there, maybe some little mini trunking or something like that. That would have been a nice to have, but yes, too much mess to make at this stage, although now would be the stage to do it, but I've made that decision. So let's get started with the filling and things. A pet peeve of mine is when people don't loosen sockets off when doing painting and just attempt to cut round them. You never get a decent finish doing that, really. You're going to get either some paint on the socket, or it's just more obvious on the wall. Just loosen the screws. If you're scared of electrics and things, there should be nothing inside a socket like that that's going to harm you when you just loosen the screws, unless there's a loose connection inside, which you've then got bigger problems with your electrics. You can loosen the sockets, loosen the screws off a little bit like that, pull it just enough away from the wall that you can then cut behind it with your brush, wait until the paint's dry, and then fix the socket back, and then you don't get, if you can see it on the camera, you don't get these little lines of different coloured paint on the sockets, which just gives a really naff finish on the sockets. You can use just a little bit of 180 or 200 grit sandpaper, something like that. Just a very quick and gentle rub along the edge of a socket like that will remove any old bits of paint. And then finally, just a turn of masking tape, painter's tape, whatever you want to call it, around the edge like that. It means you can get in behind there with your brush, get a decent finish, and you're not going to get any further paint on the sockets. The shroom's had two coats of colour now, starting to look nice. Just need to gloss the windowsill and the skirting boards, and then I can get all these floor covers up and start to think about the desk. Next job that I've got to do in the office here is the light. Just got a simple light drop at the moment. I'm going to put a nicer LED flush lamp up there. So let's have a look and see what wires are in there. Let us know how tricky it's going to be. Okay, so we can see by the amount of wires coming in there that we've got the loop in the ceiling in there. So the loop in, the loop out, and the actual wiring for the light. So that's going to make the LED fitting a bit tricky because there's never too much space in the flush fitting ones. This is a modern style of LED flush fitting here. They don't really have bulbs or anything anymore. The whole fitting is sort of integrated inside. If we turn them over, you can see that essentially there isn't space on the back here. This will be flat against the ceiling. And what they're giving you there is obviously a little connection which is supposed to go up into the ceiling, but of course you need space in the ceiling to do that. That's why these jobs can get a little bit difficult there. If we take the cover off, you can see what the light looks like inside. This is your, obviously, you know, your panel with your LEDs on. That's your LED driver, and then that's your feed going out there. I was just wondering if there was enough clearance for a WAGO between where this is gonna sit on the ceiling, but if I put that over the screw holes, you can see that that's rocking on the WAGO, so there isn't even that much clearance in the back of these. I actually think what I might need to do is stand this off the ceiling slightly, either get some washers or something like that, and just build up a few millimetres of extra clearance between this and the ceiling, which I don't think you'll really notice. That should buy me enough space for these connectors in there, which can then be hidden between the plate and the ceiling. That's the light finished in the little office there. It looks quite nice. Turn it on, turn it off. It's, I say, those LED panels are sort of the most modern thing now if you're replacing a light. You can get fittings with retrofit bulbs, but sometimes it's just easier just to get those. In terms of getting it off the ceiling there, I'll show you what I did. I got this little bag of spacer things off Amazon. I'll put on a picture of what they were. Just having one of those above each of the four screws just gave me enough space to kind of splay out my connections, and then they're just between the top plate and the ceiling there, and that work absolutely fine. So the next job in here is going to be to hang some pictures that I've got. I'm just going to hang these pictures that I've got here. I'm using my laser level, can't really beat something like that for this kind of a job. This is quite a tall room, so I'm hanging them about a third down from the ceiling, which should look nice. If you break these up into thirds, if you do any photography stuff rather than on, you know, a half or some other strange amount, it generally looks a bit better. And I'm going to put three on this wall, so I'm going to mark one in the centre and then divide up either half. Then I've got one to go on this back wall. Because I don't want the drill bit to wander, I'm also going to start the holes with a brad awl as well, so I can put that to point of that exactly on my mark and just make something for the drill bit to, helps if you film it, make something for the drill bit to sit in there as well, because if drill bits start to wander off and then your pictures are off a little bit, be amazed what your eye will actually pick up on something like that. There we are, that's the pictures hung, all kind of OCD level and spaced out, just how I like it. So what these are old railway posters. These were popular in Britain, and they were basically advertised by sort of, you know, British Railways, as it says on there, to sort of tempt people off to the seaside, obviously on the rail services that serve the seaside. So they made all these series of posters, which were all really, really nicely done. They're just beautiful pictures. I really like them. I like the history of them. And I also, you know, I like to have something seasidey so that if you kind of sat working, you know, on a dull day in February like it is now, you can kind of sit and think about your summer holidays. And these are all places that I've been to on holiday down on the south coast. So I've got another one to go up That one down there that says Scarborough, that's to go up on this bit of wall here by the door opposite. And then I've got there's another one down there that says Yorkshire Dales. I haven't got room for that one in here really, because I don't want to put it over the radiator, so I'm going to put that one elsewhere. So all my seaside ones are up there and they look nice. So ignoring the fact that there's a my messy desk is stuck in the corner at the moment because I haven't built the bench, the next thing to do in here is going to be to actually get this bench built under the window. So I started working out a little bit what I'm going to do with this bench. Those slats that are clamped on there are just to give me a rough idea of the size. I don't want to just fill in just the bay window part because the desk is going to be a little bit small. It's going to be quite small anyway, really. So I'm going to bring it forwards by, you know, about to the edge of where the slat is there. So it's going to come forwards 20 centimetres, something like that. That'll give me a little kind of shelf at either side for some pots of pencils or an ornament or something like that. If I make it project too much into the room, I'm going to struggle to get to my blinds on the morning to open and close my blinds. So this is about as big as that's going to be. Obviously, it's going to be lower down than that. To actually fix it on, I don't think I want legs if I can avoid it. So I'm going to batten round the wall and see if that seems strong enough. If it doesn't, I'll have to get a couple of adjustable legs and bring one in at each side just to support the front a little bit. So the first job here is going to be to get the size, the height rather, measured up, get a laser level on the wall and get some batten fixed around the wall there. Okay, I'm about to pick up where I left off with this bench in here. This is now many weeks later in real life, but not in the video for you. So I've gone back to my notes and decided what bench height I want. It's going to be 705mm in my case, but that's the bench height that I want. I've double checked on the IKEA website, it's 38mm top. So I've taken one off the other and I need 66.7 off the floor for the top of the batten. One thing just to bear in mind if you're working with a laser like that is that the laser has a thickness. You know, it's not infinitesimally thin because you wouldn't be able to see the line. So if you're wanting to mark an accurate line around something like this, you don't want to throw yourself out by that few millimetres. So I've set the top of the laser line to where I want it, and then I'm going to mark the top of the laser line around the wall. Okay, so if you can see that, a little bit difficult, but you can see kind of where the laser line is, and then the pencil line is sitting on top of the laser all the way around. So that's nice and accurate, rather than it trying to be in the middle or, you know, sometimes it's the top, sometimes it's the bottom, something like that. I'm marking on the laser line. And then I'm coming 18 centimetres past the wall at either side to make a little shelf. So I've come out 18, then I've marked 17 centimetres out. That's where I'll finish the batten. You don't need to see the batten right at the end of the desk. It'll look nicer without. So I'll just leave 10mm gap there. So I'm going to now start to cut these pieces and then get them fixed onto the wall using the Corfix fittings. So these are the fittings that I'm going to be using. These are Corfix 120s by Metex. And these are basically designed for dot and dab walls. As you can see there, it says dot and dab wall fixing. And this is what the walls are in here, dot and dab. Okay, so I've started to get the bits of wood ready. So what I've done is I've marked a centre line on the back, marked a couple of holes in, drilled through from that side, flipped it around so you can't see the marks, countersunk it nicely. And then basically where I've got this pencil line, I'm just going to go around here. I'm going to sit it so that I can just see the pencil line on the top of the wood like that, so I know that I'm on. Mark my holes through and then just use these Corfix things to put this all the way around. It's worth noting as well with this dot and dab that although these screws look, you know, horrendously large really for what this is, the cavity is actually quite large. So you can see where I've just made my little pilot holes there. If I take this drill bit here and push it into the hole until it stops against the blockwork, you can hear it banging on the blockwork inside there. If I just put my fingernail on, pull that out, that's what we've actually got in cavity. So that's nothing, there's nothing there in that. So that's quite a lot. So we've got the plasterboard there, which is about 12 millimeters, and then a great big gap. Then we hit the blockwork, and then this amount of the plug here will be inside the blockwork. This screw then here, you can see will be inside its countersink, something like that. So actually only this little bit of the screw here
that kind of end, a third, I suppose, maybe a third of it, is what's biting into the thing there. And that's why you need a long screw. But I'll say, when you get them out of the box, you think, you know, wow, look at the size of that compared to that. But that's how this kind of fixing actually, you know, actually works and gets its strength.
So here's the batten, which I got finished last night. I'm pleased with that. I've just actually painted around that batten that I've done there. I was thinking, you know, sort of, I mean, you're not really going to see it, but if you were to bend down and look at it, then blends in with the wall a bit better. So I think that'll look quite good. Just a general decorating tip as well. What I like to do when I paint rooms is I get some jars. It can either be kind of preserved jars like that one, empty jam jars, just some kind of a glass jar. And when you're painting, fill the jar with paint from your room. If you've got a little bit extra, just write on top of it what colour it is, what make it is, and what room it went in. If you've got any bits of touching up to do in your house, you know, you knock a wall and, you know, you want to just like cover a little scratch or a ding or a little bit of mess or something like that up, it's so much easier if you've got a collection of little glass jars of all the paint in your house, because you know exactly where it is, and it's just a little amount and it's easy to give it a quick stir and touch the paint up. If you've got a collection of old paint tins and then you think, oh, I've got that paint in the garage somewhere, you get the tin out, it's gone all rusty at the top, you screwdriver it open, all the crusty bits fall into the paint and a bit of rust falls in the paint and you're trying to mix up a little bit that's not got crap in it, you know. It's just, it's a nightmare. And also they take quite a lot of space to store as well. You can, you know, you don't need to keep large amounts of old paint because they're really much use. But as I say, if you get yourself a little collection of jam jars or something with essentially touch-up painting, then it's very handy. I find that super useful. So I've got this bay ready now for the top to go on. The top should be arriving today. So I'm going to need to make a series of cuts when it comes. First of all, I'm going to need to get the exact width I want and take the end off in a straight piece. I'm going to need to mark the kind of front strips, which will be here and here. They should be 18 centimetres. And then I'm going to need to find the angles of these sort of returns, whatever you call them here, transfer that and then make some diagonal cuts, which will come to the back. So a series of very carefully measured cuts there. Okay, so I've cut the top down. I've managed to bash the wall getting it in, which I thought I would because it's nearly the width of the room. It doesn't quite fit, and I was trying to work out why because I measured it super duper carefully. And the issue is that this piece of wall here and this piece of wall here, which I assumed were level and parallel with each other, really aren't. So I've allowed 18 centimetres there and 18 centimetres there. And what happens is basically when this side is flush and parallel against the wall, and then when you come to this side, there is a nearly 20 millimetre gap. So that is way, that bit of wall there is way out from the other side. It's gone dark now, so I'm giving up for today. But what I need to do is take essentially a 20 millimetre chunk out of the backside of there. That should allow the whole thing to actually slide back. And then this gap here should disappear because this side will seat properly then. So I just need some fiddling with. I measured it as carefully as I could, but obviously the guy who did the plaster boarding didn't. So there you go, that's new houses for you. So yeah, I'll get back at it tomorrow. I'll tweak it and then I should be able to get it sitting a little bit more nicely. As I say, I've got these accessories and things here to go in as well. So I've got some of these. These are just off Amazon. Oops. Little hole things, grommet things to put your cables through, which came with a hole saw, which is quite handy. And then some kind of wire racky things, tray things for tying the cabling up, which I will get up underneath there so that you're not seeing cables all along the floor there and it looks nice. Okay, the next thing that I'm going to do is drill out for these cable grommet things. A couple of tips with these. As I say, it's come with the hole saw. First of all, as you are drilling
with a hole saw for something like that, you want the hole to be nice and plumb. So you don't want to be sort of drilling at an angle like that. You're going to find the thing doesn't sit in there. Of course, the piece of worktop is too big to get under a pillar drill, so that makes life a little bit difficult. So what I've done here is I've taken a scrap of wood, I've put this under the pillar drill, put this in the pillar drill, and drilled through the wood. So I know that this is nice and true. What I can then do is use this as a guide as I'm drilling through in order to keep the hole saw nice and plumb rather than it just being free spinning. The second thing is that this is not deep enough to go through some worktop. I mean, if you had your own, it might be, but this that they've provided here isn't deep enough. That means I'm going to have to cut from both sides. Okay, so I've got this in as good as I can get. It's not perfect. My original plan with this was to basically try and make some kind of large card or paper template and then cut using that. And with hindsight, I think that is realistically what I should have done to make this more accurate. My plan of sort of, measuring the angles and just transferring everything was, you know, if the walls were perfect, it would have worked, but they're not, so it didn't. So if you were going to attempt this, then potentially the kind of cardboard template idea would maybe work better. But I'm happy with it, it's fine. So I'll get this screwed down now. Okay, I'm getting there with this desk. Those little wire baskets, which I got off Amazon, I've put underneath there. I've trimmed the ends a little bit to move them in. And that's just so you didn't see them visually, because you could sort of see it poking down on the end. It just spoiled the look a little bit. I really need to touch that paint up. It just spoiled the look a little bit, so I trimmed it down just so that the desk gets that sort of floating look. I've decided not to put any legs on it. I don't think it needs it. I've got an extra little bit of wood to just brace it across underneath. I'm just gonna go across from the, bend down enough, across from the batten that I've already painted side to side and add a little brace, then it gives it that sort of floating look. Because I think that looks quite nice. I think some legs will kind of spoil that. One thing that I'm going to do as well is an iMac actually sits too low for my eyeline with the keyboard at the right height. If you just put the iMac on the desk, really it's too low for me, and that can be really bad for your neck, because you find that you're sort of, rather than looking forwards at a screen, you end up looking a bit downwards all day. It puts a lot of pressure on the back of your neck. It can give you kind of, you know, neck ache and shoulder ache and back ache and all sorts. All these ergonomics for computers are very, very important. I know people like to just completely ignore them, but so many people during COVID, you know, they've been sat working on a dining table, the typing height's too high, they're looking down at a laptop, you know, and then they're wondering why they've got all these horrible pains. You know, ergonomics is very important. So I used to have a little crappy piece of plywood lifting the iMac up that I always meant to replace properly. So now is the time to replace this properly. So I've got some offcuts of this top, obviously from where I've cut these things out there. I've got two offcuts in the garage. And then from another piece of furniture I bought, I've got these little feet. Thank you.
There we are, that's that finished. I think that looks quite nice. Obviously, it's exactly the same top, so it matches the top. And then it's got these feet underneath, which will spin up and down, so I could just set the height to whatever I need. It doesn't need to be really high, it's just that extra few centimetres to lift it up. I think that was worth doing. Okay, I am nearly done with this desk now. I'm going to get this finished off today. All I've got to do fix the marks on the walls that I made, trying to get it in. And then my last little job is getting the power and networking from there over to there. So, to do that as neatly and invisibly as possible, or hopefully, I've got some 20mm white conduit, which I'm painting the same colour as the wall. You're not supposed to run electrical and networking in the same conduit. It can interfere with your networking and stuff. So basically there'll be like two bits of blue pipe as such going across there, which hopefully will just blend in. Hopefully it'll look okay once I tidy it up. This hole that I filled in the wall looks like an angry ghost, which has made me laugh. As if it's... There we are, you've just seen me fit those little bits of painted conduit there. I think that's worked okay, actually. Painting plastic like that's a bit of a faff. It will paint with two coats. If you catch it with anything, the paint will just chip off. That's the only thing you need to be careful with it. It's obviously that, you know, your emulsion for your wall is not PVC paint. But if you want a colour match on it, then, you know, that will work okay as long as you're careful with it. So I'm happy with that. And it gives it a kind of slightly steampunky industrial look. I know, I actually quite like it, to be honest. Now it's painted. Yes, it would have been better if there were some plugs under here, but it wasn't really possible without me paying a lot to get somebody to come and do it. So I'll just put the plug top on the end of that cable now, get that fired in, and then I should be able to get all the cables tidy under the desk.